Good morning, Bethany.
Good morning.
So good to see you this morning, a week after Resurrection morning. We're going to start by singing Agnus Dei, which means Lamb of God. First, John 1:29 says, "Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world." God gave Jesus to be killed like a lamb for our sins so that we could live forever. Let's rejoice in that. Please stand and sing with us. If you remember the theme verse from Romans 8:37, say it with me. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Let's sing.
Oh,
Let's sing another. Resurrection power. Let's sing about that great power that we have because Jesus died for us on the cross. So much in your precious name. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, thank you so much for being here this morning at Bethany. It is good to see each and every one of you. Trust that, look, the sun's coming out. Yay! Hey, there we go. That's awesome. But if you are joining us in person this morning, special word of welcome to you. It is good over these last couple of weeks to see more and more of you coming back. It's good to see Lisa Milligan here this morning. And so many of the others of you that have been popping back in over the last couple of weeks. Good to see the Pierces here this morning, Barry and Nan. And so we are just glad that you're here. As you came in this morning, hopefully you were greeted warmly. And if you're new here today, a special word of welcome to you. And we would like to invite you, particularly if you're in person, out in the Commons at the Welcome Center. There are welcome gifts for you. Hope that you will receive one of those with our thanks for being here. And use that information and learn a little bit more about Bethany and the things that are going on here. Want to also make a special mention and to notice the people that are watching us online. So glad you've joined us this morning from wherever you are watching from. And if you would be so kind as to leave a comment in the comments as they flow throughout the service, that is a great way for us to know that you're watching us. Maybe you're a regular Bethany person, haven't come back yet. Let us know that you're out there. Maybe you're watching from somewhere else, out in the interwebs somewhere. Let us know where you're watching from. But information is available to you this morning for our service and the things that are going on at Bethany, and a link is provided in that stream of comments. We trust that you'll just click on that and see the things that are happening here. Good to see each and every one of you this morning. Want to mention Tuesday evening, prayer meeting, 7 o'clock downstairs in Fellowship Hall, or you can join us on Zoom. That information is available in your program this morning, and you can do that there. Also want to mention, yesterday we had the first of a second men's study. Meet downstairs Saturday mornings, every other Saturday morning, 8:30 for about an hour and a half. Just light refreshment, light breakfast, light coffee kind of thing. And a time for us to look at the Word together, pray together. And so that's every other Saturday. So the next one is April the 24th. So be aware of that, gentlemen. Also want to mention our other men's study that meets weekly. It meets weekly on Thursday evenings at 7 o'clock, and that meets on Zoom. And that is run by Bob LaPerrier. And so if you would like more information about that, it's also available to you. Would invite you to check that out, too. Out in the Commons at the Welcome Center is this last week, we are going to be hosting an information class. Maybe you've been coming to Bethany for a little while and you're like, what in the world is, you know, what goes on behind the scenes, so to speak? Maybe you're interested in a little bit more of a partnership with us and finding out, well, how do I become a bigger part of what's going on here? The information class is the first step to do that. And so if you're interested, sign up there on that sign-up sheet. We'll get in touch with you. We'll coordinate a time to get you together. And we'll run through that information with you. That's the first step in membership. Because you come to the information class doesn't mean you have to be a member, but it just means you're interested in finding out more about how things work. And so we invite you to do that and to be a part of that. Also, out at the Welcome Center are some devotional books, not only the Daily Bread, but some that are particular to the season, this Easter season that we're come through. And so we invite you to grab those if you would. Couple of special announcements for you. Want to draw your attention to two items that are out at the Welcome Center. The first are these cards, these kind of 4x6 or 3x5 postage cards kind of thing. These are from CareNet, Pregnancy Resource Center in Fitchburg. They are hosting Thursday evening, that's this Thursday evening, April the 15th, 7 o'clock, online, a virtual fundraiser. As with so many other nonprofit and other groups that rely on the giving of people to do their work and their ministry and to serve, CareNet has struggled with that this year. And so they've put together a virtual fundraiser this Thursday evening on their Facebook page. This little card, as well as our Friday email, has all that information. And we invite you to check it out. If for no other reason, yours truly actually has a little 5-minute segment, 6-minute segment there. And so check it out. Check it out. And we encourage you to be a part and to partner with that ministry as we do as a church. And so grab one of these cards or that information. The other thing is, particularly for ladies, ladies retreat coming up in September. Registration opened for that April the 1st, so registrations have been coming in. Registration is made with the camp, and then we kind of coordinate here, all of the ladies that are going. Please speak to my wife, Debbie. She's out at the Welcome Center in the Commons normally on Sunday mornings, and she can get you more information with regard to that. I want to thank you so much for your faithful giving, and you're going to notice that this week, as we do towards the beginning of each month, we've included a little financial update with regard to where we're at financially as a church. Some of you have been amazing in terms of keeping up with giving and supporting the ministry, even in your absence. Those of you who are here, thank you for your faithfulness, but just keep your eye on those things, because it's through you that the ministry happens, and your faithful stewardship of the things that God has given to you, and we appreciate that very much. I'd like to turn it over now to Deacon Al Bump. Al's going to lead us in prayer this morning, share some prayer requests with you, and then we're going to turn our attention to the Word. Al?
Good morning.
It's
good to see you all this morning. A lot of prayer requests this morning, but let's start with the most important one. Let's pray for revival. Let's continue to pray for corporate, individual revival. Let's pray for our church family. All of us sitting here today, everyone who's still at home watching through Facebook, let's pray for our church family. Please pray for Randy and Leah Hinchcliffe. Randy had a stent inserted in his liver, and he's resting comfortably. And please pray for Leah for peace and strength through the Holy Spirit. And these are cousins of Joe Westbury. Jim Walgren had his heart catheterization, and he has an appointment tomorrow morning at 9. Was it 9:30? 9:30. He has a consult appointment. Jim is longtime member of Bethany, and Jim is just had an incredible attitude with all the travails that he's been through. So please keep Jim in your prayer. Pray for Debbie that she has the Holy Spirit to lean on to, and the rest of us as well. We are a Christian family. Let's please be there for Jim and Debbie as they go through this. Carol Erickson went through some medical tests to determine what's causing her eye problems. So please pray for Carol. Carol, if you're watching, we miss you. And Kurt, please continue to pray for them. Ray DeBugnara fell at home, and he's struggling with balance issues. And he has a doctor's appointment tomorrow. So please keep Ray and Barb in your prayers. A lot of things going on a Monday. Mondays. Carol Dunn is having an endoscopy on Thursday, April 15th at UMass. So please pray for Carol and hope that if anything's found, it's benign. So please keep Carol in prayer. Pray for the Zaza. We always need to pray for the Zaza every week. They're our group, and we just need to continue to keep them in prayer. Lord's doing a wonderful work there. We need to pray for the United States of America. Lord needs to do a wonderful work here. Jesus Christ is on the move, and we are all brothers and sisters in Christ, and we have that to always be thankful for. As we talked about yesterday, we need to pray for a can-do attitude here at Bethany so that we live the gospel every single day, and that we carry the gospel message to our neighbors here in the Gardner area. The best thing we can do is to be examples of gospel living and bring hope and love and humility and friendship to our neighbors, whether they're believers or not. I'm so glad to see all you all here today. Barry and Nan and Lisa, it's good to see you all. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're grateful that you've seen fit to extend the faith and grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, here to us today. We're grateful to be brothers and sisters in Christ here at Bethany Baptist Church. Lord, we ask that you look upon us today And continue to give us the power of your Holy Spirit. Help us to hold the Spirit in our hearts. Help us to constantly get up when the world knocks us down. Lord, help us to recognize that in spite of everything that's going on, we have you to look forward to because we have eternal life through your Son, Jesus. Lord, we're grateful that you've given us the means to help our neighbors and to help our church family. Lord, and we lift up Jim and Debbie Walgren today. We ask that you please, if it be your will, give physical healing to Jim. And we ask that you strengthen Debbie in her heart, Lord. Help us to surround them with prayer. We lift up Randy and Leah Hinchcliffe, Lord. We ask that you please be with Randy and heal him physically. We ask that you strengthen Leah as you would Debbie, Lord. And we also ask that you be with the Westberries as they try to be there for their family members. Lord, we lift up Carol Erickson for physical healing. And we ask that you please work through her doctors as she undergoes these tests. And we ask that you also please bless her husband, Kurt. Lord, we ask that you please be with Ray and Barb DiBugnaro. Please help Ray as he struggles with these balance issues, Lord. But more importantly, please continue to be with both of them and strengthen their faith. Father, we lift up the Zaza people. It's inspiring to see the work that you're doing among them. Please help us to continue to keep them in prayer. Lord, we lift up our nation. Help us to be light and hope as Christians for our neighbors. And Father, as always, we continue to pray for revival. We know that if it be your will, you will revive not only us, but our neighbors and other Christians across the nation. And we desperately need revival, Lord. Father, we also finally ask for continued hope and humility through our faith in Jesus Christ. We ask that you help us to live the gospel. We ask that you help us to be examples to our neighbors. And we're grateful that you have given us this hope through the resurrection of your Son. And it's through him that we pray. Amen.
How is that thing attached? Oh, wrong way. This way. There we go. Hey, thank you, Al, for leading us in prayer this morning. Thank you again for each of you being here to join us in our time together. Let me invite you to notice two items that are in your program this morning. The first relates to prayer, and one of the things that that is important to us is that we are a people of prayer. And that we focus on prayer, we pray for one another, we pray for our country, we pray for places where it's hard to be believers, we pray for people's needs and the diversity of needs that people have. And so so please use that prayer guide that's made available each week in your personal times of prayer, and join us when possible on Tuesday evening for prayer. The second thing that's in there that I'm going to invite you to take out is your message guide, which is going to help you walk through our time together this morning. It also allows you to reflect on the things that we've talked about during the week through the Bethany at Home section on the back page, and we invite you to use that to just kind of bring your thoughts back to what we discuss on Sunday mornings and to think a little bit about applying those things to your daily life. One of the things that we are going to be talking about, and we're going to talk about kind of leading into this little series, we're going to be talking about families, and I want to mention just the blessing that happens when you hear about new family members, new kids, new, you know, grandkids, great-grandkids. I know that the Westberries are expecting a new great-grandchild, correct? And I believe also Tom and Joni Elborn, their son Tom 3, and his wife Alicia are expecting their first. And so new babies on the way for our families. We've got the Cushings, going to be first time double, triple, quadruple grandparents kind of thing. And that's awesome. That is just awesome. And we celebrate together with these families. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you so much for the time that you give us to look together at your word, the time that you give us each week to recharge and to reflect and to recoup so that as we walk out into the days which are before us, we do so with strength. Lord, we thank you for your presence that goes with us. Lord, I think of Moses in the Old Testament, and you invited him to ask you anything. And his response was, Lord, will your presence go with me? And so, Lord, may it be that your presence will go with us throughout our week, each and every day. And Lord, we think of that particularly as we talk about the things of the family over the next number of weeks, that God, your presence would fill our homes, that it would fill our lives, and that God, you would be glorified in those things. So bless today. We pray and we ask that God, you would help us. God, if we're distracted, if we're just overwhelmed with the things which are behind us or the things which are before us, Lord, help us to just set those aside in these moments and allow you to speak to us. Lord, we pray that you would give our minds, fill our minds, God, with your truth, warm our hearts with it, and give us something for our feet to do. We pray that we might not be forgetful hearers, but those people who apply your word to our daily life. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you've got your message guide. Let me also, if you have a Bible with you, or if you're watching, you have your Bible, Psalm 128 is where we're going to be this morning. Those verses are also included in the message guide. So if you don't have a Bible with you, that's okay. You can follow along there, or you can follow along on the screen, and we invite you to do so. One of the things that that we have been working through, and it was already mentioned this morning by way of the song that we sang and the verse that we are encouraging you to commit to memory, is that we're spending a year focusing on the idea of being more than a conqueror in Christ. We don't want to just be conquerors. We want to be more than a conqueror. We want to be able to look at our spiritual journey and see many areas where we are successful, where we are victorious in being what God wants us to be. And we are working our way through this year a number of different places where we can draw from Scripture, biblical principle, teaching from Scripture, so that we can fine-tune our doing of what God wants us to do. And so we started with an example. We talked about that. We worked our way through the whole issue of giving, and how do we do that in a way that honors the Lord. We've been working our way through, and so we're going to start this week and work our way through the parent holidays of Mother's Day and Father's Day with a series on faith at home. How can I be more than a conqueror in my home? With my children, with my grandchildren, with those that I am related to. How can I do that? And I want you to see, even though it's a number of messages, and don't think, wow, that's a lot of time to be talking about the family. There's little places in there where we're going to take a break. We're going to take a break and focus on communion the first Sunday in May. We're going to take a break and we're going to focus on Mother's Day. So we're going to do some different things along the way. So don't say, oh, my stars. So many weeks on family, too much. No, it's all broken up, and you know what? It won't even feel like it. Trust me. And so we're going to start today by looking at what I believe is an introduction. And in many senses, you know, message series for pastors are really like one message that kind of just went wild that they find they have to just break it up because they can't do it in one shot. And so this is like one kind of message thing that went wild, and now I had to break it up, and it just kind of just grew and grew and grew, and so we're trying to organize it in some intelligible fashion. But we want to start today and introduce where we're going. And we're going to do that by looking at Psalm 128, verses 1 to 4, which is our passage for this morning. And let me invite you to notice it along with me. You can follow along in your insert, in your message guide, if you would like, or here on the screen. It says, "Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. When you eat the labor of your hands, you shall be happy, and it shall be well with you. Your wife shall be like a fruitful vine in the very heart of your house, your children like olive plants all around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. Now, I think everyone would agree that the structure called the house is not nearly as important as what goes on in that house, and that is the creating of a home. I think you would agree with me on that. That we all, if you would, have places that we live, houses, but what happens in those houses, the homing of them, is really what is most important. You know, and when you think about having a house, none of those houses were built without a blueprint, hopefully. If your house was built without a blueprint, you live in a shack or a shed, or it's ramshackled, or it's just a mess. You know, things are crooked, stuff don't fit right, the trim is a little kilter. And so if you're building a house, you want to have a blueprint. You want to make sure you follow the blueprint so the house is put together correctly. It's the same with our families and with our homes. God did not leave us without instruction, without a blueprint on how to put together our homes, how to make a family, how to lead our families, the things that are necessary for us to have good and godly families. And so we want to take these weeks and we want to reflect on the things that are necessary for framing out and building these kinds of homes that will honor God and be a lighthouse for Him in our communities. Now, in doing that, I want to lay out some things this morning, again, by way of introduction. And again, let me just say and bring this to your attention. Why are we going to do this? And the first reason is this, and this is the blank. It goes in your insert there. The first is because the home owns spiritual development. The home owns spiritual development. I'm going to just be honest with you. The church does not own spiritual development. It doesn't. The Christian school, if you sent your kids to Christian school or your kids are in Christian school, does not own Christian or spiritual development. If you homeschool your kids and you go and you're accessing something online, some kind of a Christian education tool, and you do it that way and you stream it and you're interacting that way, that resource does not own the spiritual development of your child or of your home. The home owns that. I could put it to you this way. The church, school, any other thing that you can think of other than your home and your family is a supplement to, not a substitute for, raising your children and growing your family in godly things and in spiritual development. And so it is so important that we get this, we got to get this right from the start and understand that. The second thing I want to suggest to you is that the home is where we belong. That the home is a belonging place. And you know, family is a place where we belong, whether it is a single parent family or a traditional mom and dad family. It's, you know, those that we're related to. It's where we belong. And the reason that is important, and the reason we belong there, is because family and this relationship is the greatest determinative factor in a person's life. If it is true that the home owns spiritual development, then it is also true that the home is where we belong. Why? Because that is the greatest determinative factor in terms of how we're going to, produce godliness in ourselves and our families and each other. And so this is foundational for our society. It's foundational for our churches. The relationship between, and we, you know, we include in our program, our prayer guide, a word to pray for our country, to pray for our community, those types of things. Tuesday evening we do so. Our brothers, when they lead us, we try to remember and we take that opportunity to pray. Why? Because there isn't one among us who hasn't noticed the slide morally and in terms of the culture of our country and our world. And we need to be proactive in terms of working in our houses, which contain our homes, our families, so that these families grow the way that God would desire and the way that God would want. So why? Because the home is key. The home is fundamental. The home is where we belong. And the home is the one where that spiritual development primarily happens and where God desires for it to happen, has told us it needs to happen. Now, if you go all the way back to the beginning, we're talking Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1 contains some verses 26 through 28 that talk about how God, in the flow of creation, made man. And one of the things that he did when he made man was he made man in his own image. Male and female, he created them. And it's a statement with regard to family. It's a statement with regard to God's work and the way that he's put things together. And sometimes, we lose Genesis 1. We lose these things kind of in a, kind of a transactional way. I take this, you get this, And we forget the bigger meaning behind the idea of image, the idea of what God has placed into us and the way that he's made us, his desire for us. And as we think about families and as we think about those things, one of the things that I want you to walk away from today, and it's our transforming truth, it's where we're going to kind of jump off of in these moments, it is this, that the purpose of our families is to glorify God by transferring the purposes of God from one generation to the next. So what are we doing here? We are, as families, the purpose of our family is to transfer and to work to transfer the purposes of God into the young lives generation after generation after generation. It's God's desire for us in our families to be the ones that are passing on these important truths about who God is and what he has done, about how he desires for us to relate to one another. What are our relationships in the many spheres of life supposed to look like? To take that opportunity to pass on from one generation to another generation the image that he has planted in us. There's that technical sense in which we are all human, all right, that transactional, we are created in God's image. There's a humanity, there's a nature that's been placed in us that's been planted there by God in creation. But there's also a sense in which we are transferring an image. In other words, what does it mean to actually live that out? What does that look like? And so we see as our purpose as families, it's to glorify God. And the way we do it is to take those purposes and to transfer them into young lives over and over and over and over again. So that we, bearing the image of God, also communicate and pass on the image of God into those who are there and around us. Now, when I talk about this, I'm going to acknowledge right up front, very first week, very first word out of the gate. When I talk about families and when we talk about home, for some of you, it brings a very warm and it brings a good feeling. But I also recognize that for many of us, it doesn't bring a good feeling, but it brings a guilty feeling. It challenges us, it gives us a little tinge, if you would, because there have been some things maybe in your past, in my past, that are just hard to kind of navigate. And they relate to this most basic of relationships, the family. Because why? Families are key. Families are where we belong. It's where we, in large measure, find our identity. It's where God desired for us to receive that image instruction. And for many of us, and at different times, all of us, our families were less than what maybe they should have been. And so I'm just saying right now to all of you, I understand, because I feel that way too. But just because something didn't work well in the past does not mean you can't begin to work well now. And we know in Scripture that what the locusts have stolen, Scripture says God can replace. And so if you are willing to allow God to help you walk beyond where you are at and to walk to something new, do not be surprised. And I can say, I believe from the truth of the word, that God will work and will use your family and will use you in a mighty way in that family. But let's just be real. It's hard. It is hard. I also have to say, some of us, none of us are perfect parents. But just because your child, your son, your daughter, your grandkid, your grand whatever, or just because they chose to go prodigal, doesn't lay the blame on you. That there are a lot of kids who choose to do things that are completely outside of what they received in their home. Because even though we give it to them and we instruct them and we seek to lead them in that, it's a choice for them to receive that and to embrace that and to walk in it. And so some of us may feel guilty, but I want to encourage you to not feel guilty unnecessarily. And we're going to talk a little bit about how do you work through that issue a little bit later this morning, but also in the coming weeks. So what are we going to do? So this morning, let me start out by giving you, I want to give you six reasons why we just can't seem to get this right. And then I want to look at Psalm 128 and kind of unpack that with you. So quickly, six reasons why we fail, why we can't seem to get it right. The first is this, is because we are incredibly influenced by our culture. I mean, that should go without saying. The influence of our culture is just so profound. James McDonald, pastor, said this, "There used to be just two ways to get into your house, through a window or a door. Now, because of technology, there are all kinds of ways for things to get into your home." Isn't that true? I mean, the more we have grown technologically, the more exposed our children and our families and have become to things that you would not want them to be exposed to. It's hard. And it calls for us to be very proactive in new ways in terms of how do we navigate all of these things that are now so much a part of the world of our young people, our children, our grandchildren. You know, and let me just say, this applies to all of us. We all need to have a pretty good idea and ought to have a good idea on how God wants our families to run. Because if it doesn't fit for our own family, inevitably you're going to be talking with somebody who says, "Oh, my grandkid, they're just crazy," or, "Oh, my son or my daughter, they're just off the edge," or you know, or someone younger talking to you, "My mom or my dad, they're just, you know." There's a little nibble in here for everybody. All right? But the first thing is to acknowledge the influence of culture. All kinds of ways that these things get to us, get to our kids. In the old days, if you would, oh my, that's pretty scary. In the old days, you could monitor those things. But it's almost impossible to monitor all of those things. I remember when our kids were growing up and cell phones, you know, when cell phones were proliferating. Everybody and younger years were getting cell phones, kind of thing. And we held off for quite a while with our kids, you know, to give them a cell phone. Just because everybody had it, you don't have to have it. You don't have to have it because everybody has it. You know? And so, but what one of the things that we did was occasionally we would take those phones and we'd check them out. We'd check them out. Where are you going? What are you watching? What are you seeing? What apps are downloaded on your phone? And so you had to step up your game. You had to learn new tools and new things in this to monitor computers and tablets and smartphones and all of these things. We need to learn how to filter this exposure. The second thing, I'm going to move on from there, is that we're discouraged due to hypocrisy. We're discouraged because of hypocrisy. The second reason why image fades and why this is so hard is because our kids get discouraged and they're disillusioned because of the hypocrisy and they're disappointed by the things that they see. Let me tell you, your kids and younger people are much more in tuned with what's going on than you might believe. They see things that you don't necessarily think that they see. They sense things in how you relate to your wife or to your husband that you might not think that they pick up on. And I believe that there are a lot of younger people out there who are just struggling due to the hypocrisy of people like me, of older people, who take them to places like this on a Sunday and hope that they get their cup full of morals, but during the week live a completely different way. And it's discouraging. And it diminishes our ability to build into them and to maintain the image of God that He would want for their spiritual journey and for their spiritual growth. It's hard. It's hard. It can't be do as I say, not as I do. It needs to be do as I say and do it also because that's what I do, because it's right. I have to be mindful of that. Number three, let me mention this. We fail to show our relationship with Christ as the context of our life. We've talked a little bit about this in previous sermons, the whole idea that many of us see our spiritual life as a fallback. We see it as a reference point. We don't see it as something that is actually the context from which we approach life. That in the midst of whatever we walk through, that sometimes we go back and we say, all right, well, what does God's word say about this? Rather than making God's word the starting place for how we interact with these things. And so our those around us don't see Christ as the context, as the center of our life. They see it as something that we kind of go back to if we need to. So I'll navigate as best as I can, but if I can't navigate, then I'll go to Jesus. They don't see it. And we need to have Christ at the forefront, top priority, right up front in our life. Because that communicates to our kids, communicates to those that watch us. Let me mention number four. We are not intentional about spiritually nurturing our families. Not intentional about spiritually nurturing our families. The busyness of our lives, the things that creep in, all of those types of things, we don't take the time and mark out the time, schedule out blocks of time to have conversations, to pray with our kids, to have time in the Word with our children. And there's an intentional, you can't expect them to learn everything that they need to learn, or even, I've got some figures I'm going to share next week about the amount of time compared to church that your kids will spend. Your kid, and even you spend very, very little time of your life in church. The vast majority of your life is lived outside of church, in the context of house and home. And if it's not happening there, if it's not intentionally happening there, you're behind the eight ball. And we fall short, we fail. Number five, let me suggest this. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be so heavy, but I want you to see the importance of what we're going to talk about here. Sometimes we fail because we pull back from, rather than press into our children's spiritual struggles. Sometimes when our kids go rogue, when they go prodigal, when they choose to kind of go, you know, if you would, when they come off the rails, you know, it's hard to know what to do. And sometimes we get embarrassed because our child made a certain decision or whatever. Let me tell you what, I'm not a pastor's, but as a pastor who has kids, there have been times when, boy, I had to just smile and they did some goofy things. But I didn't step back from them in those moments. I needed to learn to step into that moment I couldn't step away from them at that moment. I needed to step towards them in that moment. And that really kind of brings us to the last, and these, they're related together. But number six, we do not know how to embrace them without endorsing their behavior. That's a hard line. If how do I love my kid, embrace my kid, how do I come alongside my kid when they do crazy things and not feel like I'm signing off that what they did was right, but I want to support them so I can get them back online and get them back on track. And learning that fine line and how to navigate that line is not easy. It's not easy. We tend to what? We tend to pull back. We tend to step back. We don't want to intentionally encourage it. But we want to let them know that no matter what, we still love them and still want to be a part of their life and still want to guide them and still want to direct them and still want to have input. So six reasons why I think we struggle. Parenting is about making sure that when they leave your house, that they have all that they need in order to face the challenges that they're going to face as they journey on their own. And that's scary. Isn't it scary? I know when we dropped our oldest off at college, it was the first one out of the gate. Boy, that was tough. That was really hard. And when it came time to do that for our second son, that was tough. And that was really hard. And then our daughter, the third out the gate, the last one, that was a celebration. And it was really nice. Yes. But that was hard. It wasn't easy. Sorry about that. She's going to watch this. She'll be like, what? What are you saying, Dad? And I can tell you that there wasn't a time when I didn't drive away from the campus or from the dorm when I didn't wonder if there wasn't something that I missed that they're going to need. That if there wouldn't be a challenge, that there wouldn't be a situation that they would walk into and they would not have the resource to be able to navigate that. None of us are born parents. There's a reason why God gives us children as this. Because we need all of those years to learn how to do it and how to navigate those things. And just as they learn to grow into adulthood, we learn to grow into parenting and navigate those things so that hopefully we can bypass some of these things, some of these reasons why it's so easy to get tripped up and to fail. Let's turn our attention to Psalm 128. Psalm 128 is a psalm. It's a psalm of ascent. And that doesn't mean it has a particular odor. It's a psalm of ascent, going up. And a psalm of ascent basically is a psalm that was used when families were on their way to Jerusalem to celebrate festivals. It would be a song that they would sing as they would travel together, and it would rehearse biblical teaching. It would rehearse history so that they would remember where as a people they came from. It would remind them of the truths of God so that they would be able to interact with the things that are going on there that they were participating in. It was a reminder of the promises of God, and it would be used to lay a foundation. And this really is a psalm of foundation. Of family foundation, and it reminds us of some of the things that relate to family and some of the things that relate to putting together good homes. And so I just want to give you two big points this morning because we've got other things to do. And the first is this with regard to Psalm 128. It reminds us first that God is the starting point. That God is the starting point. And we see that in verses 1 and 4. And this is a very simple portion of Psalm 128. And these are very simple truths, but I hope you can hold on to them and use them during the week to kind of just reflect. God is the starting point. This is what it says, verses 1 and 4. It says, "Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord." God is the starting point. The starting point is a focused, single-minded commitment. The way you build a godly family is not from a Christian bookstore or from CBD or from... The way you build a Christian family is with, primarily out of the gate, number one, a firm and solid commitment to God and your relationship to Him. It's where it starts. It's not conferences, although they're good. It's not workbooks, although they can help. Some of us have never been to a family conference. Some of us have never been to a parenting conference. But one of the things that we always see is this: decision precedes process. Decision, commitment, precedes process. There needs to be a commitment to put God first and for Him to be in His rightful place before you do any of this other. Because if we do all the right stuff, but God isn't in the right place and isn't first, then we are what? We're hypocrites. And so we need to step back and put God in His proper place, His proper priority. God as the first person in my life, the first place in my life. And then bring the other things along. Notice he brings up two ideas here that I believe are really important. And it's this: blessed is everyone who fears. And that is the idea here. And it's actually a word for reverence. Blessed is the person who reverences the Lord, fears the Lord. Blessed is the one who's in awe of Him. I wonder, do your grandkids, do your kids, does your husband or your wife, do those around you get a sense that you're in awe of God? That you reverence Him? That you live in fear in that appropriate way of Him? Do they know that? Do they sense that? Do they know that you love His presence? That you don't come on Sundays out of obligation, but you come because I love to sing and I love to be with His people and I love to hear His word and I love to pray. I love those things. And if I wasn't here, I'd feel like something's missing. I can't tell you how many of you who are away, even though you joined us online and in different ways, there's just nothing like being in church. Just nothing like it. Just feels right. It's like home. Because church is what? Church is a family of families. We're a family of families. And it's a good place to be. And so the first thing in terms of putting God first is that we reverence Him, we fear Him. And we want people to see that. We need to grow in that. The second is that we need to live in obedience to Him. We need to be in obedience to Him. Notice what it says, I'll click back so you can notice. Who walks in His ways. There's an obedience issue here. There's an obedience issue with regard to how we are doing this. Reverence and obedience go together. I fear Him, I walk in a way that pleases Him. And again, this is not the idea, this walking is not, it's not just the idea of, the physical walking. It's an idea of the tenor of my life. It's the idea of who I am. It's the lifestyle. It's a modeling. It's a direction. That when people see me, they see a life that's given over to fearing and honoring Him. And I want to model that for my kids and for those around me. So what are we projecting? What are we giving off? What are we modeling? It starts with God as our starting point in our families and in our lives. But second, and this is verse 2 and 3, sandwiched in between here is if you would, the peanut butter and jelly of it. And this is what it says. It's a promise. God is the starting point, and He gives us a promise. When we reverence him, when we are obedient to him, what happens? Well, first, there's a promise for you, and it's nice. He says this, when you eat the labor of your hands, you shall be happy, and it shall be well with you. What's he saying here? What's the promise to you? What's the promise to me? Well, the first is that he's going to sustain us. He will sustain us. Working under God and being in obedience is always fruitful. There's a fruitfulness to that. He honors you because you've honored him. He blesses your household because you're blessing him. And I'm not talking about, you know, quid pro quo. You do for me, I'll do for you. That's not that. It's not transactional in that sense. But the idea is that as I live my life in a way that glorifies and honors God, God sustains me and he takes care of me and he provides for me. And then not only does he sustain us, he satisfies us. What does it say? It says you're happy. It's the idea that you experience joy, internal celebration because you walk with God and you know his presence each day. He satisfies you. He sustains us. Not only though is there a promise for you, but there's also, if you would, a promise for your family. And this psalm here really kind of targets men, but I think the principles we can apply across the board in our lives. There's a promise here for our family, and he goes in, this is verse 3. Should have changed that, sorry. Your wife shall be like a fruitful vine in the very heart of your house, your children like olive plants all around your table. So as I, as a dad, as the leader of my house, live the way that God wants me to live, as I reverence and obey him the way he wants me to fear him and to obey him, I see that he sustains me and he satisfies me and gives me life. And there's a rollover of that goes into my wife and my kids. Our whole family is blessed as we pursue these things. And so what do we see here? Well, first, there's a blessing on my wife and she likes to be blessed, don't you? But there's a blessing here. And he uses this picture of the vine. She becomes like a fruitful vine. You know, a vine, it is interesting. A vine is not the trunk. The vine draws its sustenance, its nourishment. The vine needs the nourishment. It needs the support of the larger. And so here, he's saying there's a blessing that comes on your wife and she's fruitful. And also, let me suggest this. It's not only that, it's your children. Your children are blessed. Now, there's a general fruitfulness here. And it's, he uses the idea here of the vine, the fruitful vine. But he also uses the idea of the olive. There's inherent in that vine a fruitfulness that comes. Some of you have already experienced this, maybe as you've had kids that have grown up. Maybe you've seen it in other kids. But it's so interesting to see our kids now that they're in their 20s. And to see things that they do that really surprise us. And not in a bad way. But to see that somehow there was, wow, all of a sudden that is so mature. That is so smart. Where'd that come from? They didn't get it from us. Maybe they did. Our wives are blessed. Our children are blessed. So just by way of introducing, God has placed on the family the primary role of passing on his purposes from generation to generation. And it's our calling as parents, and brothers and sisters in Christ to make sure and to work so that that image of God that is passed on, those truths of God, those basic principles of God, those teachings that God would want us to have, to make sure that those are passed on from generation to generation, from level to level. But we live in a day and an age where that's not easy, and it's very easy for us to get tripped up. It's very easy for us to fail. It's easy for us to be overcome. Some of that comes from outside. Some of that is just dealing with us. But God's call on us, Psalm 128, for our families is to put Him first. Put Him first. Put Him in that first place. And then to work from there and to see that as we put Him in that place, he has amazing, amazing promises. And He blesses in amazing ways that we might not expect. And so as we kind of start this little reflective series on being families and being families that nurture our kids and grow our kids in a way that pleases Him, I want you to take some time this week, and I want you to reflect on that Psalm 128. And that information is available there in your Bethany at home, and just allow that to kind of soak in, kind of saturate you a little bit. And as we unfold more and more each week, may it be that God blesses us and leads us so that we will be victorious. We will be more than conquerors in our families. Maybe it'll be that God will lead you to a place to do things in your family you've never done before. Maybe it's God will take you to a place where you experience restoration in an area that you've just been struggling in. I don't know. But we're trusting God to do great things as we look at our faith at home. Let's pray. Father, thank You for this moment. And Lord, we just are so thankful that, Lord, we have families, that we can be a part of a family, and that, Lord, You have given us a blueprint. You have shown us Your desires for us in those families. So help us, God, to kind of sort through these things, kind of take some opportunity to reflect and just think about them. And Lord, we pray in the coming weeks You would help us to just navigate some of the specific challenges that are ours as we think about how our faith at home works. If we ask it in Christ's name, amen. One of the things that's cool, one of the things that's neat, that's not much better. One of the things that is, no, that's not a better word either. Let me just say this. Being together as a church family brings me great joy. And I hope it does you too. And one of the things that we're able to do as a church family is to reflect not only on areas where God has spoken to us, but we're instructed to reflect back on specific things so that we can carry those things forward and remember them. And one of the things that we're told to reflect on and to look back on is part of that Holy Week, that Passion Week, Easter Week, where Christ went to the cross for us. We call that time of reflection. We call that the Lord's table. We call it the Last Supper. We call it communion. In some places, it's referred to as Eucharist. When you came in today, you received a little cup and wafer, and it contains some juice and a little wafer of bread. These are symbols, we believe. They're symbols that remind us of Christ's body that was broken for us, of Christ's blood that was shed for us. For people who have come to know Christ as Savior and who have opened their hearts to Him, it keeps at the forefront for us just how that relationship with Christ was brought about. And it was through a wonderful gift. we do this together as a church family. Maybe you're joining us this morning and you're at home, and if you know Christ as your Savior, you're more than welcome to join us in reflecting and remembering this morning. But we hold these and we take them, we share them together so that we might remember. In remembrance of me, the scripture says. We see that as Paul shares it in the book of 1 Corinthians in chapter 11. He said, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let me invite you to take, and I can hear that some of you are already doing it, and you'll notice the first little flap that is there. I invite you to pull that back carefully and expose the little wafer, and to take that, just hold it for a second. "This is my body," Jesus said, "which is broken for you. Do it in remembrance of me." Let's remember in these moments what Christ did for us to bring us into the family of God. Let's share in the wafer together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your body. It was beaten, it was bruised, and it hung on the cross for us, and we are thankful. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. In the same way, Paul, as he spoke with the Corinthians, he shared what Jesus had shared with regard to the cup. And as he shared it with them, he said, in the same way, after he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he come." Let me invite you to carefully pull back that second tab there and open where the juice is. The scripture reminds us in the book of Hebrews that without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission. So that all throughout the Old Testament that sacrifices were made, and Jesus was that once for all sacrifice, shedding his blood on the cross for you and for me. We remember, we reflect on that. It's how we are brought into the body, the gift of Jesus for us. And so Jesus uses this picture in that moment to signify and to symbolize his blood, which would be shed on that cross. We remember both of those on Good Friday, and we remember it today. Let's share in the cup together. A lot of family stuff going on this morning. We worship together as a family, and new parts of our family are new members, not new, old parts of our family, older parts, I don't want to say old, oh, that's, people that are a part of our family are coming back, and it's good to see them. And we talk a little bit about the family today and God's desire for the family. As the body of Christ, we share together at the table. As a family, we remember that Christ offered his body for us, and his blood was shed for us. And we celebrate every Sunday. Why? Because he didn't stay dead. We know he rose from the grave. And we receive from that wonderful victory, resurrection power to live each and every day the way that he desires. We can be the families he wants because he has empowered us through his Spirit to do that. But another thing that we want to celebrate today with regard to family is I'd like to invite the Spencers to come forward and Spence or Richard and Jerry and their daughter Elizabeth are joining us this morning. Joining me, I should say, up front, and have been through an information class, a membership process, and we are pleased this morning to be able to welcome them as partners here in the ministry of Bethany. And I apologize. I'll stand a little over to the side. Great. It's our custom to welcome new members on Communion Sunday because it's such a family-oriented service. It has a lot that we do together beyond just the singing and hearing the word. We come to the table together. And it's my privilege this morning as the pastor to welcome you in partnership to Bethany. We believe that it is important that we grow in our commitment and in our level of service in the body of Christ where he has placed us. And the Spencers have sensed that this is a place where they want to grow and can grow and that they can serve and help others grow. And we're excited about that, and many of you have done the same. And so we want to take this opportunity to welcome them as a church body. I hope that you would be willing, following the service, to join me out on the sidewalk. Remember that word this week. And we will just have a moment to say hello to people distanced and just give them the opportunity to welcome you this morning. So during the last song, perhaps, if you could kind of slide out and our ushers will dismiss people and they'll have an opportunity to see you there. But we have a little gift for you. And it's a book called I'm a Church Member by Tom Rainer. And it's just a reminder for you to look at and to reflect on and to just think about all that goes into partnering with a church and becoming part of the body of Christ here or anywhere. We're so pleased to have you. We're excited that God has led you our way. I'm going to ask, as I give these to you, for our chair of our deacon board, Al Bump, to come and pray for you. And then we've got our hymn, our closing hymn, and we'll be on our way.
Welcome. Heavenly Father, we're grateful that you've seen fit to bring us the Spencer family. We ask, Lord, that you help us as a church to embrace them, welcome them, and support them as new brothers and sisters in Christ here at Bethany Baptist. Lord, we ask that you remind each one of us all believers are welcome in the family of Jesus Christ, and that as members of this family, we support one another through prayer and whatever it is that you call us to do as members of this family. Lord, this is a day of celebration, as every day should be a day of celebration, but especially today as we welcome the three members of the Spencer family. Lord, we ask that if it be your will, we ask that you please use them and us to carry your gospel into the community and to show an example of gospel living and gospel worship. And we pray these things in your Son's most holy name. Amen.
So in closing, let's stand together as we sing A Christian Home, based on that great tune, Finlandia.
Yeah.
things we talked about today was making sure that Christ's spiritual things are the center, the focal point of us as individuals, as families, not just a reference point. And that song just brings that out. It's just a wonderful thought. May it be that this week we figure out how to do that better. Our benediction this morning, taken from the book of Colossians chapter 3. Therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Thank you so much for being here today. The Spencers are going to head out. I'm going to make my way, and then the ushers are going to come and dismiss you. Look forward to greeting you out on the sidewalk. Thank you so much for being here today. God bless you, give you a good week, and we look forward to seeing you next Sunday.